Thanks, everybody. Welcome to Build. I am Ricky Camilleri. Our next guests are the stars and the director of one of the most romantic and sweet teen films to come across in some time. Every Day tells the story of a teenage girl who falls for the soul of someone that transforms into another person every day. Quite the conundrum. In just a minute, I'll bring our guests, the stars Angourie Rice, Debby Ryan, Owen Teague, and director Michael Suscy out. But before that, let's take a look at a clip from Every Day.
Maybe it would be fun if we just went somewhere. You have a nice smile.
Story checks out. Good job, Cookie.
I am someone who wakes up in a different body every day.
Always someone my age. I'm never too far from the last, never the same person twice. And
I have absolutely no control over any of it. The day that Amy shadowed you at school, I was Amy. And the day that you went to the beach with Justin, I was Justin.
It's not possible. You have a nice smile.
Hey, it's me.
Every day of your life, you've just woken up and
just tried to live that day for that person.
That sounds really lonely.
It isn't, because I know what makes each person different and what makes everyone the same.
Why are you doing this?
The day we met, I felt something I've never felt before, and I don't want to let that go.
I am so proud of you.
Oh, thank you. What about us? I'm in love with someone who wakes up in a different body every day. Always the same age, never the same person twice. You're such a bright, beautiful, kind, funny
person.
Michael, we are gonna miss our flight.
My family's supposed to fly to Honolulu today. Michael. If I go, tomorrow I wake up as a kid who's not flying back here. Oh my God, this kid does not exercise. What about all the broken, happy ever afters?
Hey, what about I have to go.
Wait!
Stop!
Who even was that? I'm forcing Alexander out of his own life, and it's wrong.
What are you saying?
Think about what happens if you and I stay together.
We can make it work.
I want to believe that. What will happen to your life if I'm the person in the world that you're closest to? What about us?
What about us? You know, I thought you'd left.
I'd never leave.
Other than every day.
Everybody, please welcome the cast and director of Every Day. We have Debby Ryan, Angourie Rice, Owen Teague, and Michael Suscy. Hey, guys.
Hey.
Thanks so much for being here.
We're excited to be here.
Yeah, thanks for having
us. Thank you. Yeah.
Please, thank you for being here. Michael, let's talk about how this started for you. What made you as a director want to take on this this tale?
I've been looking for a long time to do something set in high school. I grew up on John Hughes movies and those kinds of high school romances and kind of teen angst stories. And they sent me this script, and the fact that it was in that set in that world, but with this metaphysical twist, this slightly sci-fi kind of an idea of a soul traveling and into multiple bodies, I just thought was like the best combination of two different kinds of project I'd want to do, all wrapped into one.
You find a great way to keep the story totally grounded in this kind of sci-fi, and I wouldn't even say sci-fi, but this sort of metaphysical setting.
Yeah.
But you never really let it drift. Was that hard to do?
I'm often attracted to projects that I think could ride a line like that. That could be either, you know, melodramatic or campy or something like that. And I, as a director, the idea of keeping it between the tracks and not going off the rails is something that really interests me.
And Gori, talk about your character.
So I play Rhiannon. She's sort of, I guess, the typical American high school teenager.
She hates her name, which is ridiculous.
Great
song.
Yeah, right. And she has a boyfriend called Justin, and their relationship isn't as great as it could be. You know, it used to
Justin's
be a lot
kind
better.
Of a D-bag.
Yes. So you can't say that word on live.
You can say whatever you want.
Okay.
I also didn't say the word. I hyphenated it.
Yeah. she has this amazing day with her boyfriend, and she finds out that this person was actually a soul who has woken up in the body of her boyfriend. And it's sort of, the film tells their love story, and they have to overcome a lot of challenges.
What was it like to sort of play with a variety of actors but having the same kind of emotion for because each actor is supposed to be the same person for your character, and you have to sort of play against them as if they are that same person, but it is a series of different actors.
It is, yeah. It was kind of tough because you just sort of meet someone and then you have to like jump in and be super vulnerable and emotional and
yeah. But imagine
kiss them.
Yeah,
a lot of those are like one day. Like you kind of show up and it's the new person that day, and you do your scene or scenes, and then the next one.
Yeah, but I mean, in terms of acting, that was really exciting for me. It was a challenge, and on a personal level as well, it was just great to meet lots of people. I love making new friends, and now I have friends all over the world, so yeah.
Debby, your character, you're the kind of the big sister, and sort of playing a spot-on teenager, I think.
Thank you very much. I had experience.
Yeah, how did you capture that? How much of that was you, and how much of that was the character?
There were definitely some moments watching the edit where I was like, oh yeah, that was just us like mucking around in the car. Like, or that was, us kind of when she wakes me up and I just am responding by like flipping her off and shutting the door. It's very, very grounded within kind of actual reactions. And it's interesting kind of approaching Jolene as like someone who you check in with throughout the movie, and she kind of is very similar and very consistent in a lot of inconsistency happening in Rhiannon's life. And it was kind of nice to be able to have that amount of like levity and angst. And we also had a lot of we rehearsed together and kind of stepped into their relationships with their parents, and before and after the dad's manic episode, and being kind of within that world. So I think it was interesting and it was informed, but I think that within the edit you just have this like fun, interesting kind of character and dynamic.
I didn't even think of that when I was watching the film, that her life is so inconsistent, and your character is kind of presented at the top as someone who is also inconsistent, but as we progress through the film, as you said, she is the most consistent person within her life. Was that something that you talked about beforehand?
I think it's something that Jesse Andrews, who wrote the script based off the novel's actually told from A's point of view, and one of the first things that the screenwriter decided to do was to make Rhiannon's character the protagonist of the film, and in doing that, it made sense to flesh out the family. The family's not even in the book, and so Jolene and Lindsay and Nick are all creations of Jesse, based off of the world that that David Levithan has created in the book. So I think it really helped inform your character. And I loved how in the beginning of the film, Rhiannon's really defined by all the other people in her life. She's Justin's girlfriend, she's mm-hmm. Jolene's sister, she's Lindsay's daughter, and part of her journey is coming into her own and becoming her own person and with her own identity, not defined by others.
What was it like? I mean, I imagine you read the book before you started shooting, but what was it like sort of having this completely different protagonist and approaching it from a totally different angle?
I mean, it's more of a film convention to have the audience follow somebody, because when you're reading the book, you can kind of do it in your imagination and you're following that, but when it's actually visually on screen, changing actors all the time is difficult. I mean, we do it sometimes when you've got a huge age gap, like say a teenager and someone who's a grandmother, kind of a thing, and it's the same person and you're intercutting. But if you were trying to track a story and constantly changing actors without being rooted in Rhiannon's point of view, I think it'd be very, very difficult to follow the movie. So I was excited that Jesse had made that change to David's story, and David embraced it as well.
How did you direct all these different actors in each scene? Did you try to sort of tell them to be a little more like what A is like, or did you sort of try to maybe let the lines do the work for them?
I don't think I did too much. I mean, maybe Owen can talk about that. I wrote, first I think it really happened in the casting. I cast actors, even though everybody's 15 to 20 years old, who I perceive to be old souls. And I really did that through the eyes
Old souls,
all you guys are, yeah.
Yeah, and, I see it.
And then the second thing I did was write a letter to all the actors before we started production, because actually in some of these screenings, some of the actors are meeting each other for the first time, because Angourie's really the only one that got to interact with all the different A's. And so I said to please read the script all the way through for A's character, as if you were playing all of A, even if you're only playing one iteration of A. and so that everything that happens before and after.
You think they all did
that? I think probably 95%. No, they did. They did.
Yeah, who
they
didn't? Who do you think didn't
I'm
do
not
that?
Tell you. I think
Name names.
Maybe one person didn't do their homework, but I will not say who it was. Because you can't tell in the movie. The performance is great.
That's always the weird thing about performances, though, right? Like, you know, an actor could show up and not do their work, and then in the editing room, you're like, oh, they're just great no matter what. This is fantastic.
I'm not kidding. It really does go back to the old soul thing. I mean, it really, there was this connective soul personality. And I also want to credit Angourie for just being all in and believing that this, you know, difficult to accept premise was real. And because we're following her and because she believes, we believe.
And I imagine because the other actors are reacting to you a lot in the scene, that also sort of creates the reality of who they are as well. Like what you present to them helps build their character on those single days that you have to shoot them. Owen, you're coming off of the wild success of It last
yes.
year, right?
Yeah.
Did you shoot this before or after?
I shot this after.
What was that like? Because it's a different character.
Totally different character. I mean, it's really reassuring when you go from playing like possibly the most evil child to ever exist, to like the sweetest guy ever. It's nice to know that you can also be really, you know.
Do you rest somewhere in between the two, or are you on the sweeter
Yeah, I'm.
Side?
I mean, I'm actually pretty terrible. I don't know. I mean,
we had a lot of the same crew, and
yeah, we did
they,
have.
They
a lot
would
of the same
like
crew.
Like lean over to me and be like, "Wow, he's just so different."
That's good. I mean, I hope I'm more like Alexander than you know, he is someone to aspire to, as is A. But no, it was really fun to get to just do something different.
Owen's one of the actors who, as well as Angourie, who gets to play both A and the other characters.
Yeah.
Some of the actors only play A
are just
in that other right. character's body, but Angourie plays A and Rhiannon, and Owen plays Alexander and A. And yeah. In the audition process, seeing everybody do a different, slightly different version was really important to be able to delineate the characters.
And you really just kind of drop in Alexander at the top of the film in a very subtle way. I mean, you have so little to do, I think, in that quick scene that you're in, but I think you are foreshadowing, we are supposed to extrapolate that you will come back around. Is that something that you think about as an actor when you're doing that scene, or is that kind of just like, oh, no, my guy's just being nice right now?
I mean, one hand, you don't want to give it away because, you know, it's a surprise when it turns out to be, you know. But on the other hand, you know, you have to kind of put in the kindness of Alexander. And so there's, I think, during that scene when Justin is standing up there and talking about how, you know, his life sucks, I'm kind of like watching from the background, like, what? Yeah. So, yeah, but you don't want to, like, give things away at the same time.
Right. In It, I'm sorry, I saw it last year. I had a bunch of people here for it. I see a lot of movies in a year. There's a number of bullies, but are you the one that actually carves the kid's
stomach? No, I'm not the one that carves the kid's. That's actually...
I didn't think so.
That's actually a guy that both Angourie and I know, named Nick.
He's also a nice guy.
He's Australian, so that's why we know.
That's why he's carving stone. Yeah, I got it.
Yeah.
Those Australian kids.
What's that supposed to mean?
You got dragged.
Oh, hidden.
Defended, yes. I'm the guy with the flamethrower.
Right, that's right. Sorry.
I love how that's a sentence you can say.
That's something that
it
I can say now.
Absolutely be your Twitter bio. Right.
I'm the guy with the flamethrower.
With that movie, you're either the kid, the guy who carved the stomach, or the guy with the flamethrower.
Or the guy with the flamethrower, yes.
Embarrassment of riches there, really.
Yeah, I know. That was an actual, like, I would actually do that. And, it hurt on occasion. It's fun.
People have asked me if I have any advice for people who want aspiring actors, and I'd say get yourself born in Australia.
Yeah. Exactly.
Why is that?
No.
What's going on with that? I find that there's a lot of great Australian actors trying to save myself.
Something
from my
in the water.
Yeah.
No squirrels, right?
There are no squirrels in Australia.
It's part of probably why it's so amazing.
Because squirrels really get in the way.
Yeah, they do.
I know, they're distracting. They're a squirrel.
I want to talk about a song that's in the film that I brought this up in the green room with you. Definitely going for a John Hughes vibe, but you're using one of the great, I think, songs of the 80s, which is The The's This Is The Day.
Yeah. Johnson from
Obviously, it fits in the film for so many reasons, but when did you find that song and when did it occur to you?
You had mentioned in the green room that it's like a song that keeps popping up on your Spotify, and it was like that for me, you know, even before Spotify. Like I'd put it on mixtapes, and actually, I did start my music supervisor started a John Hughes playlist when I was in pre-production to just sort of get my head
into
it.
Can I ask what was on that? Do you remember?
Oh, it was all the stuff from Pretty in Pink, and it was from. I ended up watching some stuff from Ferris Bueller and 16 Candles.
Weird esoteric songs on the Ferris Bueller soundtrack.
Yeah.
Songs that are actually hard to find. There's like this song by the Flower Pot Men, Beat City.
Yep.
It is actually like not a very easy song to find.
It's not. I mean, the last song in 16 Candles with Molly Ringwald and the Jake character. You know, Over the Cake. It's like those kinds of songs are so memorable. And OMD's If You Leave. Those songs, for me, had like a feeling of nostalgia. They're that feeling, which is very relevant to this film, about, not a doomed love, but like you're a love that is, you're in love, and it's also painful of a separation at the same time. And that kind of feeling of nostalgia while you're in the moment is a very peculiar thing, because you think of nostalgia as being looking back on the past. But I those songs, for me, evoke a feeling of nostalgia in the present or while they're happening, you know, as a teenager. And so that was the feeling that I wanted to evoke with the soundtrack. And The was a song that fell into that for me. And then I built out the sound of the entire movie kind of from that place, like going in all directions from The.
And you have these kids, sort of these contemporary kids right now, dancing to The and knowing the lyrics. Did you ever feel the need? I love that you didn't explain it. That no one at one point was like, well, my dad liked this song, so this is why I know it. You were just like, no, they know it.
Well, you have the line that you say.
Oh, really?
when she thinks that, when she doesn't realize that, when she doesn't know that that A is in Justin, she thinks just Justin, she's in the car just with her boyfriend, Justin.
Yeah.
And what's your line? You say,
you know the song?
Yeah, and then yeah. She says, how do I not know
that? Yeah, yeah.
So it is, which is weird to her, because it's not the type of song that, that Justin would normally know. But how she knows
most that teens would normally know.
So I didn't know it, but when my dad read the script, he was like, oh my God, I know this song. I love this song. So yeah, I had to listen to it on repeat and like learn it, but it's a great song. Yeah. I do like it.
It's a good repeat song. It's nice. Let's get some questions from our audience. Who has a question? Way back there, yonder.
Sorry. Hi. So I was wondering, what was your favorite thing to do offset when the cameras weren't rolling, especially since it's such a beautiful location, this movie?
Oh, well, it was my first time filming in Toronto. So I went to the CN Tower, we shot at the aquarium, which I loved, and I also went to Niagara Falls because everyone told me I had to do it. And yeah, I was like a hardcore tourist, but I really liked it. I like Toronto, it's pretty.
Love Toronto.
I broke my kneecap into two pieces like 2 days before shooting this, actually. Which
is why you're in a bed or in a car for everything?
Yes.
Yeah. That is, yeah. Or if you see
or
me
blocked
like,
by something.
Yeah, I'm just like already landed on a mark and just leaning in a doorway because I only had one functional leg. But Michael was super, super cool about being accommodating to that. And so I actually ended up bringing my mom to film with me. And so she would push me around the CN Tower and the aquarium in my wheelchair. And we just like got to wander. And that was very fun. But normally I would have done more movement-y things.
Shooting every day was actually my third time in Toronto, so I didn't do quite as much touristy stuff, but,
cool guy.
Oh yeah, super cool.
You're a local.
another of the guys in the movie, Jake, is actually in it as well, and so, it was fun to see him, because he's from Toronto, but one of the things that we did, I remember, on set was, You brought your little ukulele.
I did.
And I brought my mandolin, and we, like, played a couple times.
That was really, really fun. Yeah. Had a musical jam session.
Yeah, in between setups or whatever.
A very musical cast, actually. I'm dying to do a musical, so I feel like I've got half my work done. I think I know who we're going
to
do.
Is there a part of you that wanted to throw that, like, caught them playing? Was like, how do I get this into the movie?
I actually do have a little teeny video. One day we were in the high school, and I just sort of leaned in with my phone around the door, and you guys are there. But I haven't posted.
Oh no! Please don't, God.
There's actually a little, I guess, an Easter egg? It's not really, because it's not something people really know, but in Alexander's room in the film is a mandolin, which you put there because I play it.
Yeah.
It's cute.
Yeah. It's cool.
Next question.
The mandolin's coming back.
Hey, it's a great instrument.
Never left. So my question is for Owen. So you played a lot of dark roles with It, Bloodline, and Black Mirror. Mm-hmm. So how was it like being in something much more lighthearted? Is that what kind of drew you to it?
Yeah, I mean, well, the really cool thing that drew me about this movie was this, like, this sort of philosophical, metaphysical aspect of, like, a love story with this, you know, emphasis on empathy and love and acceptance and seeing people for, you know, who they are, but with this cool kind of like twist of almost, you know, it's never been done something like this, but also playing a nice guy was refreshing. Yeah, no, it was fun, and it's hard because you have to, like, yeah, it's a totally different way of thinking than, you know, being people like Patrick or whatever. So, yeah. Yeah.
I think we have time for one more.
I was wondering, what was the funniest thing that happened on set?
Oh, my God. Well, this actually happened before filming, so I don't know if this counts, but I was scheduled to have a tonsillectomy, and I was in the running for every day, and it was a Wednesday, and they called and they said, you might have to fly to LA on Friday. And I kind of had to say, oh, I'm scheduled to get my tonsils taken out on Friday. But I ended up actually canceling the tonsillectomy and flying to LA, and I kept my tonsils in for this film. So this is the very last film with my tonsils.
That's an IMDb like fact that we would have.
Unaware.
I would say the funniest thing was the fact that Angourie has just turned 16 and had not yet learned to drive. And in Australia, they drive on the other side of the road. And so I wrote her and said, you drive, right? And she's like, no. So she got her learner's permit, and there's a scene that is, it's a piece of it's in the trailer, and it'll be on the DVD extras, but it's not in the movie, of her outside in the Target parking lot with Jake Sims, who plays Michael, who was in It, that Owen just mentioned. And she has, it's like an empty parking lot, and she has to get into the spot. And she's driving down, and then she turns, and she's 50% in one spot and 50% in the other.
Yeah.
So then we do a second take, and then she's also not in the spot. And so we're running out of time, so from off camera, I just have her drive straight into the spot and not turn.
And I haven't driven since I filmed the movie. Like, wow. I haven't driven in Australia or in Canada or anywhere.
I'm a traumatized.
Yeah, I'm done.
It was very funny.
Guys, congratulations on the film. It's funny. It's beautiful. When can people see it? How can people see it? February 23rd?
February 23rd.
Yes. And in Australia on April 5th.
Okay, yes, in Australia on April 5th
yes.
as well. Everybody give them a round of applause for every
Thank
day.
You guys.
Thank you.